Welcome to the seventh lecture in the course Engineering Electromagnetics. In the last lecture, we considered the behavior of voltage and current on a general transmission line, general in the sense that it incorporated losses, and we saw the effect of these losses on the various aspects related to the transmission line, the formation of standing waves, the input impedance, etcetera. Today, what we will consider is the use of transmission line sections as circuit elements. The first question that will come to mind perhaps is, why or in what situation do we need to use transmission line sections as circuit elements? The reason for this is the following. What happens is that conventional circuit elements do not perform as expected or do not behave as expected at high frequencies. The reasons for this misbehavior can be traced back to time delay and the high frequency effects. But what kind of misbehavior do we have in mind here? We are quite familiar with an inductance or an element which is supposed to behave as an inductor. Showing a lot of resistance, okay. In addition, at high frequencies, what may be quite significant is the interturn capacitance in the windings that are made to obtain an inductor. Similarly, an element which is expected to behave as a capacitor may have associated with it what is called a considerable amount of lead inductance. And of course, a wire wound resistor may have considerable inductance associated with it. Now, it is not that these effects are completely absent at low frequencies. The problem is that the values of these elements that are required to be used at high frequencies are themselves quite small, and therefore, these small effects become quite significant as a fraction of the actual element value that is required to be used. And then the frequency is high, therefore, the associated reactance with even small capacitance or inductance can have a considerable effect. And it is because of these reasons that the conventional forms of the circuit elements do not behave as expected at high frequencies. There are solutions to this problem. One could use what are called thin film circuit elements, but what we talk here today is the use of transmission line sections as circuit elements, which also is a a very convenient way of solving some of these problems. And the problem is of a considerable significance in the frequency range, which is a few hundred megahertz, hundreds of megahertz. That is the kind of frequency range where this kind of problems come up. The basis for the use of transmission line sections as circuit elements is of course the input impedance seen at the terminals of a transmission line with some termination at the other end. The expression is quite familiar to you by now. The input impedance is Z naught times Z L plus j Z naught tan beta L upon Z naught plus j Z L tan beta L. Under what conditions or under what situation is this the expression for the input impedance? Either lossless situation or low loss approximation. This is the input impedance at a distance L from the load impedance Z L. All right. Now, let us consider the behavior of a short circuited transmission line. A short circuited transmission line would be one where Z L is equal to 0 and therefore, Z N is simply j Z naught tan beta L. It is completely imaginary, it has no real part and varies as the tan function varies. And therefore, in a straightforward manner one can make out that depending on the value of the argument beta L, the overall input impedance could have an inductive behavior or could have a capacitive behavior, and therefore, appropriate lengths of sections of short circuited transmission lines could be utilized as inductors or capacitors. All right. One can put it down more definitively. Here beta is 2 pi by lambda and the behavior is inductive if beta L is less than or equal to pi by 2, let us say less than pi by 2. Of course, this is the situation when the argument lies in the first quadrant. Similar behavior will be obtained when the argument lies in the third quadrant. For the sake of simplicity, we are not listing all mathematically possible values of beta L. All right. So, for beta L less than pi by 2, the behavior is inductive and the corresponding length is less than lambda by 4. A short circuited transmission line section with length which is less than lambda by 4 will show an input impedance behavior similar to that of an inductor. The actual inductance value that one will be realizing at the input will depend upon the length and the wavelength or the product beta L. And since tan function can have any value from 0 to infinity, any inductance value can be realized. Similarly, the behavior will be capacitive if beta L lies between pi by 2 and pi, or L lies between lambda by 4 and lambda by 2, there will be other ranges of beta L or L where again similar kind of behavior will be shown. Similarly, an open circuited transmission line can also be utilized for the same purpose. Here ZL is infinite and therefore ZN has an expression which is minus j Z naught cot beta L, which again has similar characteristics as the tan function, and therefore an open circuited section of a transmission line could also be utilized as an inductor or a capacitor. The ranges of the inductive behavior or capacitive behavior can be easily identified. It is going to be inductive if beta L lies in the second quadrant, that is pi by 2 is less than beta L is less than pi, or correspondingly L lies between lambda by 4 and lambda by 2. Similarly, it is going to be capacitive if beta L is less than pi by 2 or L is less than lambda by 4. And this way you see that we can use sections of transmission lines effectively either as inductors or capacitors. These are going to be low loss transmission lines, therefore associated resistance is going to be quite small and they will behave as expected as designed. They will not be corrupted by lead inductance or stray capacitance effects. If we consider a particular length of short circuited transmission line, let us say a quarter wave short circuited transmission line, lambda by 4 short circuited transmission line. Then based on this expression for the input impedance, which is derived from the general expression for the input impedance pertaining to low loss approximation or lossless approximation, we see that for this situation where L is lambda by 4 and beta L is exactly pi by 2, an infinite reactance is indicated. Okay. But in practice things remain finite, and if you want to find out the exact value of the input impedance, then we need to go back to the exact expression for the input impedance incorporating the small amount of loss that is invariably present. Let us work it out. We have Zi equal to Z naught tan hyperbolic gamma n. This is the general expression for transmission lines for the short circuited transmission line, that is ZL is 0, and this we write out as Z naught then sin hyperbolic gamma L, so that it is alpha L plus j beta L upon cos hyperbolic gamma L, which is again alpha L plus j beta L, which can be expanded quite like sine and cosine of a sum of two angles. Okay. With a bit of care, one can see that this expands into Z naught into sin hyperbolic alpha L times cos beta L plus cos hyperbolic alpha L and then j sin beta L. Okay. Divided by cos hyperbolic alpha L cos beta L plus j sin hyperbolic alpha L sin beta L. Now, substituting the condition that it is a quarter wave short circuited transmission line, that is beta L is pi by 2. This simplifies considerably and we get Z I as Z naught times cos hyperbolic alpha L upon sin hyperbolic alpha L. One can simplify this further, recognizing that alpha L is small in practice. We use low loss transmission lines for practical purposes, and within that approximation, using the small argument approximation for cos hyperbolic and for sin hyperbolic, this simplifies to Z naught into 1 upon alpha L. What is the expression for alpha for low loss transmission lines? That was derived earlier. The expression for alpha was half R by Z naught plus G Z naught, and we said that in practice the second term is much smaller than the first term, and therefore this is simply R by 2 Z naught, and therefore the input impedance for the case we are considering is simply 2 Z naught squared by R L, which is the case not only for beta L equal to pi by 2, now we could generalize, which is the case for beta L equal to all odd multiples of pi by 2, 2 n plus 1 into pi by 2, or alternatively when L is an odd multiple of quarter wavelengths. Okay, which is not infinite, it is still high, a high value, because for a well constructed transmission line R will be quite small using good conductors. So, it is still a high value, but you see that it does not go to infinity in the practical case. Same behavior will be shown by half wave or lambda by 2. Open circuited transmission line sections. Okay. Once again, starting with the exact expression for the input impedance and then substituting ZL equal to infinity in that expression, one will find that ZI in this case is once again Z naught into cot hyperbolic alpha L, there is no approximation here, which can be approximated to 2 Z naught squared by R L, an expression similar to that we have got for the short circuited quarter wave section. It is alpha L, quite similar to this. you will start with z naught cot hyperbolic gamma l and then proceed in this manner and substitute the condition that beta l is now an even multiple of pi by 2 and l is a multiple of lambda by 2 and then you will get this. If you have any other questions, you please let me know.
So in this case, zi is actually real. Does that mean that we can use in these cases we can use a transmission line as resistor?
You could, but this will be a very high value. And there are other alternative means of using circuit elements as resistors. For example, thin film resistors, which are quite convenient. All right. Now, next we go on to a very special length of transmission line, that is the quarter wave length, and you will find that it has very interesting properties. We call it a quarter wave transformer. What we will do is we will use the general expression for the input impedance. Zi is z naught times zl plus j z naught tan beta l upon z naught plus j zl tan beta l under the low loss approximation. And now we say that we are using a quarter wave length of the transmission line or odd multiples of quarter wave length as we have seen. So that beta l can be written as 2 n plus 1 into pi by 2 or l is an odd multiple of quarter wave length. No. So far we have considered the short circuited sections or open circuited sections. All right. Now we are not considering any particular restriction on ZL, but we are considering that the length is restricted to an odd multiple of quarter wavelength. So this case has not been considered earlier. For this, one can see easily that ZI is going to be z naught squared upon z l. There are two things that one can notice from this. The way the input impedance seen at the end of a quarter wave section of a transmission line has come out. What are these two things? First is the input impedance Zi is inversely proportional to Zl. There is an inverse relationship between Zl and Zi. Zi is inversely proportional to Zl, okay, which is very interesting. If Zl is 0, if it is a short circuit, at the input end of the quarter wave section, it will be seen as an open circuit and vice versa. Instead of taking these extreme values, one could say that if ZL is high, ZI will be low, and if ZL is low, ZI will be high. So this reciprocal relationship between the input impedance and the load impedance holds good for a quarter wave transformer. Hence, it is called a transformer. It transforms the load impedance in this manner. Okay? That is one thing. The second thing which makes a quarter wave section of a transmission line quite useful is the following. Let us make the following consideration. Let us say that we have got a transmission line with characteristic impedance Z1. All right, which for some reason, for some practical application, needs to be connected to a different transmission line, let us say like this, with Z0 equal to Z2, different in the sense that its characteristic impedance is different. In practice, it could be a load impedance which is different from the characteristic impedance of this transmission line, or it could be simply another transmission line with a different characteristic impedance. The application that we are going to illustrate is not affected by this. Now, let us say that it is connected through a transmission line in this manner, okay. Let this section be of length lambda by 4 at the design frequency, and we pose the question that can we choose a value of the characteristic impedance of this intermediate section so that the input impedance seen here at this point Zi, it is equal to Z1. That is, by interposing such a section between a transmission line of characteristic impedance Z1 and a transmission line of characteristic impedance Z2, can we match this transmission line? Essentially, that is what it would be if the input impedance seen here is equal to the characteristic impedance of the first transmission line. Okay. Now, since we have said that this is a quarter wave section, it will have the properties of the quarter wave section that we have just put down, and we will have Z1 equal to, or Zi, which is required to be equal to Z1 for matching, it should be equal to Z0 squared by Z2, and therefore, if Z0 is chosen such that it is equal to the geometric mean of the impedances on either side, then this quarter wave section will have matched this item to this item. Of a quarter wave section of a transmission. As I said earlier, while for illustration we have said that this is a transmission line of a characteristic impedance Z2, it could be just a load impedance Zi equal to Z. And the rule that we can form is that they can be connected through a quarter wave section with a characteristic impedance which is the geometric mean.
And there it will be very easy to see how a quarter wave section can be utilized as an anti-reflection coating. But essentially that is what is being done there. The impedance of one medium is being matched to that of the free space. While the application is very interesting, there is one thing which is not very good about it. The match will be perfect at a frequency where the length is lambda, on hyperwavelength where the length is lambda by 4. So if we deviate from the design wavelength or from the design frequency, it will not remain perfectly matched. This thing can be seen easily on the overhead projector, where we consider the application of the quarter wave section of a transmission line to match a load impedance ZL to a transmission line with characteristic impedance Z1. Okay, and as we have said, if we select the characteristic impedance of this quarter wave section as the geometric mean of ZL and Z1, the transmission line will be matched at the design frequency. That design frequency or the phase point is indicated here as beta L equal to pi by 2 for L equal to lambda. What we have shown here is the application of a quarter wave section of a transmission line to match a load impedance ZL to a transmission line of characteristic impedance Z1. And as we stated earlier, if we select the characteristic impedance of this quarter wave section as the geometric mean of these two impedances, then the line will be matched at the design frequency. Now here we are showing a plot of the reflection coefficient that one sees at this point as a function of beta L. Beta L can be considered to be the electrical length of this section. Okay, beta is 2 pi by lambda, and therefore theta is the electrical length of this section. At the design frequency or the design wavelength, the electrical length is exactly pi by 2. And at this point, the load is perfectly matched, the reflection coefficient is 0. As we change the operating frequency, for example, if we increase it, then the electrical length is going to increase. If we reduce the frequency, the electrical length is going to reduce. In particular, when the electrical length is brought down to 0, meaning thereby that this quarter wave section is absent, then we have a reflection coefficient which is just as if ZL is directly connected to Z1. Okay, and the same thing obtains at when the electrical length is pi, and therefore this is a periodic variation of the reflection coefficient that one is going to see. Therefore we see that a quarter wave transformer used for matching purposes is going to have a restrictive bandwidth. The bandwidth will depend upon the maximum reflection coefficient that one is going to be able to tolerate. This rho m value depends upon the applications. Typical values that are acceptable would be 0.1 or 0.2. Depending on that, there will be a certain bandwidth, certain frequency range within which the reflection coefficient will be below this maximum permissible value, beyond which the reflection coefficient is going to exceed this permissible value. And therefore, we say that that is the bandwidth of the wave transformer.
Can you explain this one again?
Yeah.
Bandwidth.
The question is whether how we relate this to bandwidth. What we are saying is that at the design frequency or at the design wavelength, the match is perfect. As we deviate from this on either side, either because the physical length is different from lambda by 4 or the operating frequency is changed, the reflection coefficient is going to increase rather steeply. Up to a certain point where the reflection coefficient is below the maximum permissible value, you could still operate this and consider that the load is matched to the transmission line. okay, and therefore you get this upper frequency limit and lower frequency limit, and the separation between these two becomes the bandwidth over which this quarter wave section will keep this load more or less maxed within the specified limits of the reflection coefficient. Normally this bandwidth is quite small, it's just a few percent bandwidth, few percent of the center frequency. There are ways and means available for improving this. For example, one could use multiple section quarter wave transformers, okay, but we are not going to going into that here.
Yes,
I think so. Yes. Sinusoidal, rectified sinusoidal.
How do you get that, sir?
One can calculate the reflection coefficient instead of using a fixed electrical length, beta L equal to pi by 2. Keep this general and then estimate the reflection coefficient. So we will get, you find out the input impedance, general expression for the input impedance here, and calculate the reflection coefficient. That is how this curve has been plotted. Anyways.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, please.
Won't there be a reflection at the junctions itself when where we have the transmission? This is quarter wave transmission.
This is the junction you have in mind?
No.
Why should it be there? Because the input impedance that is seen by this section at the design frequency is equal to Z1. Okay. One can go into the details of this, all right, and see. How the reflection at this junction is cancelled by the reflection at this junction. But overall effect is that at this junction there is no net reflection.
So the x axis, it is the length of the extended portion after that Z1 junction, so that length is plotted.
Yes, the electrical length that we are plotting here is the electrical length of the quarter wave section. Alright, so I suppose we can now go on to the next topic, and that relates to the velocity of propagation. What is the velocity of wave propagation on a transmission line? One term that we have been using is the phase velocity, designated as Vp, and we have said that it is equal to omega by beta. How we identified this expression omega by beta as the velocity was as follows. For example, for sinusoidally time varying signals, we have e to the power j omega t minus beta z, which is manipulated to read as e to the power minus j beta, and then z minus omega by beta, which when compared with a function of argument z minus vt tells us that v is equal to omega by beta. But a better interpretation of this velocity is obtained if we consider omega t minus beta z. Alright, and say that, alright, we want to stay on a constant phase point. Okay, omega t minus beta z represents the phase of the wave as a function of z and as a function of time. Let's say that we want to stay on a constant phase point. Then, with what velocity an observer or we will have to travel? That one can find out by finding out the derivative of this with respect to time, that is d by dt of omega t minus beta z equal to 0. And one can see that the dz by dt that we get is equal to omega by beta. And since it is arrived at from the consideration of staying on a constant phase point, we call this the phase velocity. We stop here today and we'll make further considerations in the next lecture.